on that note, getting into our first segment of the day, talking about the franchise tag deadline. We had a handful of moves. We had a handful of franchise tag moves themselves, and then we got some contract extensions as well from a couple different teams and players that were a little bit rumored to potentially be getting the franchise tag, and in turn got some longer term contracts done. So the final list of players that were franchise tagged, that is T. Higgins, L'Jarius Sneed, Brian Burns, Justin Matabike, Jalen Johnson, Josh Allen, the Jacksonville one, of course, Antoine Winfield, and Michael Pittman. The Patriots also used the transition tag, which is not commonly used. They did so, tagging Kyle Duggar. All of these I talked about for the most part on the show yesterday. As we were going live, a bunch of these were breaking, so now I've had a chance to sort of sit back and look at the big term picture. The one that I did not have a chance to talk about yesterday because it took place after the show was the Colts franchise tagging Michael Pittman. I really like the move for them in this instance. I think that Pittman has been a very underrated receiver for the Colts for the past handful of seasons, and I think that it's really important. He is just a pro's pro, and what he does for the Colts is provide a really solid weapon for this quarterback room that is a little bit young and unproven. Of course, they are hoping that Anthony Richardson, in his second season, he can take a step forward. He spent most of last year injured, but the little bit that we did get to see from him, he really flashed. Gardner Minshew is now a free agent. I don't imagine that they are going to be bringing him back. So I think that now it is time for Anthony Richardson to really take over the reins, show off what he has. And having somebody like Pittman in the building can really help to solidify that group. Now, Josh Downs is also a tremendous receiver as well, but he's just a little bit younger and definitely a little bit more unproven, although I think that he is a great talent as well. I think that between the two of them and having Jonathan Taylor, Anthony Richardson should be in good position to make a nice step where, you know, I think that he had a lot of doubters coming out of college. He really started coming on in terms of the media hype later in the cycle. In terms of leading up to the draft, there was a lot of unproven, and that goes back to some of the film that he showed at Florida, but I definitely believe that the talent is there. It's just a matter of putting it all together, hoping that we can get a healthy season from him, and I think that bringing back Pittman was the right decision for that. As for the rest of the names, I know we talked about them on the show yesterday, but there are really two groups when you look at this list of franchise tags. There are those who are expected to be back with their teams for the 2024 season, and those who could still be traded. So I think that Matabike, Johnson, Allen, Winfield, and Pittman will all be back at their destinations when the 2024 season starts. It gets a little bit murkier with L'Jarius Sneed, Brian Burns, and T. Higgins, where they all still could be moved despite being tagged. So we'll start by talking about some of those guys. We will start the conversation with T. Higgins. I think that he is probably the biggest name. I don't know if I'd necessarily say he's the best. I think that L'Jarius Sneed is probably better for what he does. But T. Higgins at a very important position, of course, being a wide receiver and not having him on the market makes this a little bit interesting because of the fact that when you look at the Bengals here, they are not too far removed from that Super Bowl appearance that they had in the 2021-22 season. And I think it's still very possible that long-term they could come to a contract agreement with him, but they also are going to have to pay Ja'Marr Chase. I would, and this isn't too much of a hot take or anything, I would 10 times out of 10 prefer to have Ja'Marr Chase over T. Higgins, and the fact that you are going to have Joe Burrow's contract kick in for his contract extension, and he's going to be upwards of $40, even $50 million as the years come on. And I think that wrapping up that much money in three players at two positions is just a really risky game to play. We saw the step back that their defense took last season after they lost both of their starting safeties from that Super Bowl team in Von Bell and Jesse Bates. And Jesse Bates specifically is a tremendous player. He had a great season with the Atlanta Falcons. And since then, they've been able to retool a little bit. They've brought in some more youth. And obviously last year with the Joe Burrow injury, that was really the main issue for them. But their defense also wasn't necessarily Super Bowl caliber either, but I think they took steps in the right direction, and I think that they can do some of that retooling a lot easier on the offensive end. If you are a believer in Joe Burrow, which I myself am, the Chiefs absolutely are, then you think that Joe Burrow can sort of elevate the room around him. Still, having that number one option in Chase is very important, but how much of his success has been based off of his pure talent versus the incredible receiver room that they've had over the course of the past couple seasons, because now you are losing some of these options. You lost your tight end, Hayden Hurst, the other offseason. So now as the contract jumps for Burrow, he's going to have to do more on his hands. And I think for them, their best option is probably to run into next season with T. Higgins just playing on the franchise tag. I don't think that they're far from contention, but in terms of that long-term deal, I have some concerns there, especially because we saw Joe Burrow's career got off to a rough start, specifically not because of how he played, but because of the offensive line that was blocking for him. And he tore just about everything in his knee in his rookie year, despite good play. So I think there are other, you know, areas on the roster they should be looking to invest into. The Bengals have talked about the idea, not necessarily openly about the idea of trading Higgins, but their director of player personnel, Duke Tobin, did not shut down the trade rumors like he did last offseason. He was a little more open-minded about it. He said he didn't want to get into hypotheticals or anything like that. So he acknowledged as well, and I think that as NFL fans, we can acknowledge the Bengals are absolutely a better team with T. Higgins on the roster. It's just a matter of, do they feel like they should try and capitalize on some value here, or is the true value in trying to put a contender together for the upcoming season? That's where I personally land, but they got out early in this cycle to franchise tag T. Higgins, almost to let teams know that the phone is open. They were very clear about their intentions in terms of not letting him hit the open market. If you want to get him, you got to call them. So I thought that that is an interesting conversation around the Bengals and that decision. Lejarius Sneed was given the non-exclusive tag. This was reported about a week or so ago. It didn't officially take place until yesterday, but this means that he can essentially still negotiate with other teams. They are trying to still work out a deal between him and the Chiefs, but it seems like more likely than not that they are going to move on from him. And it's also been reported that the Chiefs may be willing to accept just a second round pick for him, which is a little bit surprising to me because Sneed is an incredible player. Now, they have Trent McDuffie coming up the ranks, had an incredible sophomore season for them last year. So they have some help on the back end of the defense as it is, so perhaps that is part of it, and they're just looking to get anything that they can. But I feel like selling low on Sneed is something that would be a little bit interesting. But if that is the case, that a second-round pick, and maybe a day three pick as well, but not trading a first-rounder, There are a handful of teams that I think should absolutely get on this. Specifically, I'm looking at a couple franchises that are aspiring playoff teams that are a little bit younger and have some cap space. I think the Lions should absolutely get on this if possible, because that was, it's hard to point to exactly one area that was the Lions' downfall last season after their collapse in the NFC Championship game, but they were definitely undermanned in the secondary for last season, and I think bringing in a cornerback to the caliber of Legarius Sneed would be a big-time move for them. They are outside of the AFC, so as much as maybe there's a little bit of, I mean, I wouldn't even call it a rivalry, really. I'm just really looking at that one game where the Chiefs and Lions played, and there was a chance that they could have played in the Super Bowl as well. So giving them up to a contender, maybe the Chiefs would have a little bit of hesitation about that. But I think if you're the Lions, you don't have to give up a day one pick. I'm definitely looking to make this happen. I think that the Texans are also a very intriguing team for me in this offseason, because I think that maybe they could be taking a step back this year. I think that the Jaguars are going to bounce back some, and that division is going to be a little bit more contested. But I think that bringing in a corner like Sneed for the Texans would also be a tremendous move. So we will continue to monitor that situation. Quickly here on Brian Burns, because we touched on it yesterday, it sounds like they aren't currently actively negotiating on a long-term deal. Of course, the Panthers say they want to when they make this decision to franchise tag him, but it just seems like it's gotten really messy here. It's been really poor management from the Panthers on this. They are not going to get anywhere near the value that they potentially could have gotten for him during the 2022 trade deadline, where the Rams reportedly offered two first-round picks and a second-round pick, and yet they stuck it out with him. For what, really? He's still a good player. He had a little bit of a down season in terms of the statistics this past season, but ultimately they were nowhere near close to really competing anyways. The fact that they turned down that offer a couple years ago really is mind-blowing to me, and now they're going to have to sell him for 75 cents on the dollar, something like that. There's just less control around his contract now. He wasn't quite as good this past season as he has been in the past. Still a very good player. Still somebody that if I am, you know, looking to add an edge rusher, he could be a very valuable player. But they're not going to get an offer worth multiple first-round picks. That is, I can say that with the utmost confidence. Prove me wrong, I guess. But as for some of the other interesting moves within the group of players that were franchise tagged, you had Josh Allen of the Jaguars. They were able to get him on a little bit of a discount, actually. I wasn't sure where he was officially going to be listed in terms of positioning, but they got him classified as a linebacker as opposed to a defensive end, which actually dropped his price a little bit. So not bad for them in terms of this upcoming season. I know it's only, you know, a few million dollars, but hey, whatever it takes to cut costs, you can't really complain about that. The team feels like they are confident in being able to get a long-term deal done with him. It's just a matter of how much annually is he going to be asking for. Last season, he was tremendous, especially when it comes to finishing the plays. 17 and a half sacks is ridiculous. That does make it a little bit difficult to come to an agreement on a contract year to put up those types of numbers. Definitely makes you a very expensive commodity. And I think that it's a good thing that they got out ahead of this and tagged him, because it would have really driven up his price. But, you know, if you're the Jaguars here, you're asking yourself, do you think that he can continue that level of production? I personally do believe so. I think he's a phenomenal player. I don't know what his relationship is like with Trayvon Walker, but I think having a homegrown guy that's been a home run for them up to this point through the first year of his career, it shows your organization. We reward the homegrown talent. maybe him and Walker, he can help grow with Walker over the next few years. Walker is going to be a free agent in a couple seasons now. We're seeing some strides from him. How much can Josh Allen help him? So I definitely think bringing him back is in the team's best interest. Now, again, what that price is going to be interesting, because he's going to be at least $20 million per year, probably more mid to high 20s, especially considering the type of season that he just had. But I guess we will see what number they end up on. He is maybe a sneaky dark horse, could be traded, but I think that he's staying in Jacksonville, and I think that that's the right decision. But because they decided to franchise tag Josh Allen, that means that Calvin Ridley is going to hit the open market as probably the top wide receiver available. So we will sort of see the repercussions of that. I think that the Jaguars, while they don't necessarily have an elite receiver one, they have surrounded Trevor Lawrence with a handful of viable options at the receiver and tight end position. So I think that ultimately, if they lose Ridley, it was nice getting him in for the season and testing him out. But Ridley's also sneakily older than you may think because of the amount of time that he has missed over the course of his career. He's already in his late 20s, and that's not to say that he, you know, can't put together some good seasons here as he goes forward. He just turned 29 specifically, but we sort of, if you take look back at that rookie season that he had, specifically it was his third year where he popped and he was All-Pro second team. The fact that he hasn't really reached that height again, and he had 1,000 yards this year. It's not like he was bad by any means, but it's just the matter of consistency and showing that he is a receiver one game in, game out. That's still a little bit to be seen. I definitely expect him to get paid, though. Last couple of names here we will talk about is the Ravens franchising Justin Madubuike. Madubuike was tremendous this past season. They have a handful of upcoming free agents, and this is the one that they end up choosing to retain on the franchise tag. He just turned 26 years old, so he has his better football ahead of him. Despite how incredible he was this year, he had 13 sacks from an interior D lineman position, which is always incredible production to get. He was an All-Pro second teamer this past year, and he's been steadily improving in this Baltimore organization since being drafted in the third round a few years ago. Was not a consistent starter this year, the first time he started every game for the Ravens, and he really showed out for them. And given the Ravens salary cap situation, where they have a lot of free agents and upcoming free agents, I should say, and they have specifically a lot of guys on that defensive end, given the fact that they also still need to shed $10 million before the start of the new league year, which takes place next week, March 13th, they still have some moves to make here. But ultimately, when you look at it from the perspective of they make sure they hold on to Madubuike, who, another one, if he hit the open market, they were not going to be able to match the contract. They get him on the front line. They still have Roquan Smith as their linebacker. They have Kyle Hamilton in the secondary, so they have a go-to player on each level of the defense. They should still be a very good group. I don't think that they are going to reach the ceiling defensively that they were at this past season, but still a very solid core to have going forward. Quickly here, to wrap this up, talking about some players who did not receive the franchise tag. Talked about Calvin Ridley for the Patriots because they tagged Kyle Duggar. Michael Onwenu hits the open market. He is one of the top-rated offensive linemen. Patrick Queen of the Ravens had a really nice season this past year. He's someone that the Ravens are probably not going to be able to bring back, but we will see with that. Of course, we talked about it last week, and it's been reported for a bit now. No running backs were tagged. Not all too much of a surprise. Just either health injury concerns, age possibly. There are different things with these running backs that paying them upwards of $12 million was a little bit steep, I think, for some of these contending teams. And or the fact that some of these teams with these guys aren't in the realm of contention and paying that much money to a running back, which, let's face it, just doesn't have quite as much value as a lot of these other position players. It just didn't really make sense. And now that they are also, the fact that they're all lined up in this same free agency class means that they knew there were other options they could get likely at a cheaper price. So they were going to have a lot of running back shuffling in this offseason. That means the Giants didn't tag Saquon Barkley, of course. They also decided to not tag Xavier McKinney. I know some Giants fans that were very upset with this decision. Ultimately, I don't think it was all that big of a deal in terms of they still have a lot of holes that they have to fill out on the roster itself, and I'm sure they're going to be communicating with both of these players in the coming weeks for free agency. But I don't think that putting together any sort of a one-year deal was going to solve the long-term problems for them. I really like McKinney as a guy in the secondary, and I think that he's been showing a lot of promise for the Giants, but also I don't know how much he's necessarily going to, and maybe it is a bunch in free agency, but I guess we'll have to see there. The Giants have a lot of things they have to fix. I think it starts with the offensive line there and figure out everything from there. Christian Wilkins was a surprise to me because I think he is an absolute monster. He has been incredibly reliable for the Dolphins over the course of the past couple years. He has started 51 consecutive games for them, and he is a big-time game wrecker. He's honestly one of my favorite defensive players to watch just because he always pops up everywhere. He does so in the run game. He was career best in the pass game this past season. Career highs in sacks, QB pressures, and QB hits. He is a monster. He's going to hit the open market now. And the thing is the Dolphins are another one of these teams that are in a very tough salary cap position. So I think he's on his way out of Miami. It's a little bit tough because when I talk about the reliability of him on a game-to-game basis being available, as we saw with the Dolphins, along with some other issues, I think the biggest thing for them when it came around to the playoffs is the fact that their front seven was so injured, and it was Wilkins just being the only one really trying to hold it down. You know, they went out, they invested into Bradley Chubb at the deadline in the 2022 season, I believe it was. Chubb has dealt with injuries throughout his career, and he's a very talented player as well. But another significant one, and that's the thing, is even when Chubb was in Denver, that was sort of the reputation around him, is that great talent, can he stay healthy for you? Wilkins has been solid in every department you could possibly ask of him, and now he is going to likely go get himself a huge payday somewhere else other than Miami, as they look to sort of solidify themselves more so as an actual contender, maybe a little bit of a disappointing couple seasons in the playoffs. But we will see with all of that. We are going to be taking our first break. When we come back on the other side, we will be talking about Baker Mayfield and what his free agency looks like ahead. So stick with us, and we will be right back.